church. Good morning. Glad to hear what you stand as we get to celebrate, huh?
You are. flesh and bone. I was made for something more.
Yeah. Good morning. Go ahead, finish up that conversation. Make your way back to your seat for the day. How are we doing this morning? Some good. That's good.
I'm doing well. How are you?
Good. It feels much better than last week, right? I mean, I'm not standing up here sweating at the moment, so that's a plus. I'm so glad that you're here today. Let me try again now that more people are kind of situated. How are we doing today? Much better. You are awake in here. That's so good. I'm so glad you're here. Thank you so much for joining us, for coming out this morning. We're glad you're here. If you are a guest and this is your very first time here, thanks so much for joining us. We're glad you're checking us out. There are welcome cards in front of you. Grab one of those welcome cards and fill it out. There's just a couple of questions on there. Fill that out, and afterwards, take it out to the gazebo. We have some friends out there that will take that from you, and they will give you a free T-shirt. So make sure, if you're a guest and this is your first time here, that you go out there afterwards, you give them the card, and they're also there if you wanted to ask any questions or you had anything you wanted to talk about, they're there too. But give them those cards, and they'll give you a free T-shirt, okay, for our guests. All right, announcements, things that are up and coming. We have a lot of things coming up right now in this next season. It's going to be really great. One of the things that's going on is on Friday nights, our high school ministry is having fifth quarters. So, yes, every Friday night in September from 9 p.m. to 11 p.m. I know, it's late. We're taking all the high schoolers. You can drop them off there after football games. If they don't go to football games, you can drop them off there. Anyways, we have snacks and games and hanging out, and it's a really good time. So make sure that you're bringing your high schoolers to that up in the Alive Room, 9 p.m. Friday nights. Also, next week, can't believe that it is here already, but next week is Back to Church Sunday.
Yeah.
So the 17th, so bring your friends, your family, your neighbors in your bulletins. Did you see these in there? Pull it out. Take it out. Look at this. This is fantastic. I think this would be great when you're going around your neighbors and saying, hey, how are you? You should come to my church on Sunday. We're having Back to Church Sunday. It's got some really great information in it, and if you open it up, look how pretty that is. Isn't that nice? So you can give them this. This is for them on the back. It has all of our information on the back of that pamphlet. So it's got our address and information like that, too. So this is really useful if you want to use this when handing it out and inviting people. I think they're really pretty, too. So make sure that you take those as well. Also, on the 20th, we have two things starting up. We have Life Change You coming back. And Kid You is starting up again. They're both starting on the 20th. So that's coming up. It's Wednesdays. More information in the bulletin. And last but not least, today is the last day to register for the women's retreat. Yes. So if you have not registered yet, if you've just been thinking about it or you weren't sure or you have questions, today's the last day, so do not miss out. Go out to the patio after service. The women's ministry is at a table. You can see them. They have a banner, and they're all standing there looking beautiful. Go over to them and ask them any of the questions that you have about the women's retreat. But this is going to be an amazing opportunity. Like I said last week, there's sponsorships available. If you just can't afford it and you're really wanting to go, talk to them. See what's available. And sign up, okay? So don't miss out on that. If you're helping out with offering, go ahead and take your places, and I'm going to just pray for us right now, all right? Awesome, Father, thank you so much for today. Thank you for bringing us here. Thank you for giving us this building that we can worship you in. Thank you for this church family that I know has been such a blessing to me, and I'm so grateful for them. I pray right now as we come together and we worship you in this time of tithing, that we will give to you, that we will give to you with cheerful hearts, that we will just give to you out of thankfulness and gratefulness for the things that you've given to us. Lord, I am so grateful for all that you do for us, and I'm so thankful for this family and just for all the people here. Thank you so much for giving us this opportunity. We love you, and we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
All I need, more of you, less of me. This life, or anymore, my heart, have it all.
Means that you're giving your life, everything up to Jesus and let him do with it what he wants. That's not what you want. It's what he wants. Anyone in the room today feel like you need more of him and less of you? Yeah. God, we come before you this morning. You know our hearts. God, you know our hearts better than we do. God, we come before you this morning. We worship you with singing, with giving, with listening, with encouraging one another, with loving on one another. God, our real prayer really, God, is to show us what that means today a little bit more. For us to give more to you and want less of us. God, we pray. I pray that everyone in the room today, God, we would take the next step in that. I know many are here today, and maybe that song is not the song that they're singing from the bottom of their heart. God, I pray that you bring them closer to that. God, I pray for those that are here today that are singing that song and they're in pain or they're in sickness or they're in trouble, they're stuck in something. God, they're really crying out for you. God, just invade their heart and their life in a new and a fresh way. Bring fresh life. God, bring healing. Bring help. Bring comfort. And God, I pray for all of us that we would draw closer to you, seek your face in all of this. God, we pray for our brothers and sisters that live on the other side of this country today and are in a whole different set of circumstances. God, we pray for your protection and your provision. God, your blessing through the storm. God, as this hurricane rocks through Florida, God, I pray that it would draw people to you. God, that you would provide for all the needs. We think of Pastor Nancy as they were here last week and in Florida today. God, many family members and friends, we pray for the devastation in Texas. God, that you would continue to send your provision, meet needs. Bring people to you. And God, again, once again today, we pray that this just wouldn't be another service for us to attend, but God, we would be the people of God who grow in our relationship with you and do the will of God with all of our heart, more of you, less of us, in Jesus' powerful name. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. All right, have a seat. Wow. All right, just a couple things here before we jump into this. So Ashley reminded us that next week is Back to Church Sunday. And I told you last week, I think I told you that we're going to have a dunk tank out there, right? So bring your friends, because all your friends are going to get dunked in the dunk tank. All right, tell them we're going to have you in the dunk tank. No, we're going to have a dunk tank out there. We're going to have a party in the patio afterwards. So how many of you have a blue band on today? All right. How many of you, hold it up, all right? Good. You know what, it really doesn't do you that good in here, okay? So take it out with you and show people that they belong here. And invite him to come next Sunday. That's going to be a great service. We're going to have a great time. We'll start a new series on the church and kind of what we're about. So hopefully you'll be here for that. And then just the other thing I wanted to say is that Ashley also talked about the Life Change U starting up and the Kid U starting up on September 20th. So that doesn't mean that Zumba stops. So some of you are like, oh, no, no more Zumba on Wednesday night. There were three of you like that thought that, right? But and we still got Zumba going on, 7 o'clock Wednesday nights in the Family Center. But we'll kick off a Life Change U and Kid U on the 20th. There's information about that in the bulletin. Check it out. So we're still going to have some classes that'll really help you, especially the one, check out the one for Life Change U on evangelism. So hopefully you'll show up for that. All right, so today we're going to conclude our series on Moses, the life of Moses, called Your God is Too Small. And we've been in Exodus all this time. We're going to jump all the way to the last book of the law, the book of Deuteronomy, and Deuteronomy 34. So the last chapter before we jump into Joshua, Deuteronomy 34. So if you have a Bible, you want to go to Deuteronomy chapter 34. We're going to read the whole chapter together in a minute. If you, put that up on your phone or your tablet, whatever you're using today, just make sure, if you have a cell phone, make sure to silence that, because sometime during the service it might go off, somebody will call you, whatever, but keep that on silent. And a couple other things, if you need to get up and go out that door, make sure it doesn't slam like that, okay? So, if you need to get up sometime during the service, that's what you need to do. Just let's try to keep the distractions at a low point. And we also have a cry room in the back. So there's a room back there that has a TV in it that shows the service and the sounds in there and everything. So if kids are in here and they kind of get a little squirrely and you want to go back in there and enjoy the comfort of the cry room, that would be awesome. So take advantage of that. We do have an awesome children's ministry, so if you want to take advantage of that too. All right, here we go. So we're going to talk about the big exit of Moses today. So this part 12 is the last of Moses, and there's so much more that we could cover about Moses, and maybe next summer we'll do part 2 and kind of do the wilderness wandering part. But we're going to talk about the exit of Moses. So of course, the exodus is the exit out of Egypt. And so when you think of exodus, think of the word exit. And so today we're going to talk about the big exit of Moses, so the end of his life, and Deuteronomy 34 kind of sums that up. Hebrews chapter 12, verses 28 to 29 have been our key verse through this. Think about your God is too small, and what we believe about God, we need a bigger version of that. It says, since we are receiving a kingdom that is unshakable, let us be thankful and please God by worshiping him with holy fear and awe. For our God is a devouring fire, right? So God doesn't play games with us, right? God is holy, he's just, he loves us, and he's done everything for us, and he provides for us, but God is a holy God. He is in that sense, a scary God, right? So there's plenty of scriptures that talk about God wants to have a relationship with us, but he wants us, also to have a deep respect and awe because he's God, and we're not. So as we talk about Moses today, think about the end of his life and the end of, I want you to think about the end of your life. You know when that's going to be, the end of your life? Okay, I didn't think so. All right, so you might want to think about that, okay? Because we don't know when that day is going to be. But I found some funny epitaphs on some tombstones. I don't know if you've ever read any of these, there's just some funny things that people put on their actual tombstone, not the pizza, but the actual tombstone, the grave marker, okay? So there's one marked for a man named Ezekiel Akel in Nova Scotia. It says, here lies Ezekiel Akel, age 102. The epitaph says, the good die young. So I guess he wasn't a good guy. I don't know. Another one in Maryland, actual cemetery, says, here lies an atheist, all dressed up and nowhere to go. Okay, so... in London, England, actual cemetery, there's a tombstone there that says, here lies an man who lived an old maid but died an old man. Okay, so I'm just saying, it's what it is. Okay, so in England, another cemetery, there's one that says, the children of Israel wanted bread, and the Lord sent them manna. Old Clerk Wallace wanted a wife, and the devil sent him Anna. Okay, so, yeah. Another one in England. I guess their sense of humor in England, I guess. I don't know. A guy named Sir John Strange says, here lies an honest lawyer, and that is strange. So that's funny. Lester Moore, who was an old cowboy guy, says his actual tombstone in Tombstone, Arizona, his grave marker says this. He's buried in Boot Hill Cemetery. Says this, here lies Lester Moore. Four slugs from a .44, no less, no more. Bad. In a Georgia cemetery, one grave marker says, I told you I was sick. And then one last one, I got some others, but it's time to move on. Okay, so this guy, Harry Edsel Smith of Albany, New York, born 1903, died 1942, says, looked up the elevator shaft to see if the car was on the way down. It was. Okay, so, all right. So you've heard the commercial. What do you want on your tombstone? I mean, what do you think about the end of your life? I mean, what is that legacy going to look like? And so, and when we're thinking about Moses, this is the end of his life, and we're going to see some awesome things here, some principles to live by. But when we think, connect this with how big is your God? Each week we talk about, well, our small version of God is like this, and then the true God is more like this, okay? So our small version of God today would be this. God blesses me and my plans. God blesses me and my plans. So we ask God, God, we need you to bless this today. We're going to do this today. God, would you bless this? And we're asking God in a big way, but a small version of God, saying, God, I'm going to do this. Would you bless that? The true God who wants to bless us and is a blessing to us, comes along and he says, I have a much bigger and better plan than that in mind for you. So you have a little plan. I got a big plan. You have a small version of my plan for you. I want to show you the big and better plan for you. So today, you know the old saying, go big or go, it's not an old saying, it's a new saying, go big or go home. Go big or go home. Go big or go home. Well, today we're going to look at it like Moses going home to be with the Lord. But I want you to think about how to go big and go home, or how to go big as you go home. Because here's the truth of the matter. We're all going home, and we don't know when that date is. I hope you know what your destination is. If you don't, we're going to help you with that today. But how to go big as you go home. So I'm going to give you a couple parts of this, but I want to read Deuteronomy chapter 34, starting in verse 1. It says, then Moses, so at the end of his life, then Moses went up to Mount Nebo from the plains of Moab and climbed Pisgah Peak, which is across from Jericho. And the Lord showed him the whole land from Gilead as far as Dan, all the land of Naphtali, the land of Ephraim and Manasseh, all the land of Judah extending from the Mediterranean Sea, the Negev, the Jordan Valley with Jericho, the city of palms as far as Zoar. Then the Lord said to Moses, this is the land I promised on oath to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob when I said I will give it to you and to your descendants. I have now allowed you to see it with your own eyes. But you will not enter the land. So Moses, the servant of the Lord, died there in the land of Moab, just as the Lord had said. The Lord buried him in a valley near Beth Peor in Moab. But to this day, no one knows the exact place. Moses was 120 years old when he died, yet his eyesight was clear, and he was as strong as ever. The people of Israel mourned for Moses on the plains of Moab for 30 days. Until the customary period of mourning was over. Now Joshua, the son of Nun, was full of the spirit of wisdom, for Moses had laid his hands on him. So the people of Israel obeyed him, doing just as the Lord had commanded Moses. Verse 10, there's not been another prophet in Israel like Moses, whom the Lord knew face to face. The Lord sent him to perform all the miraculous signs and wonders in the land of Egypt against Pharaoh and all his servants and his entire land. With mighty power, Moses performed terrifying acts in the sight of all Israel. So we're going to look at that, this end of the life of Moses here, and close out this series by thinking about how to go big as you go home. And I'm going to give two parts. The first part, we'll talk about, number one, focusing on God's bigger and better plan for you. Focusing on God's bigger and better plan for you. So God, like I said, we have a small version of the plan. God has a bigger version of that. It says, this is the land. So picture this. God takes Moses up to the mountain, and he overlooks the land. So this is at the end. So they've gone through the wilderness wanderings for 40 years. And they came out of Egypt and went through the wilderness for 40 years. We talked about how important the wilderness experience and expedition is for us as followers of God, followers of Christ. But they went through that. At the end of that, they get right to the edge of the promised land. And God brings Moses up to the peak, the highest point, and he can look out. And it's like God saying, look at this, look at that. Look, can you see that? I mean, I don't know about you guys, but I'd love to be at a high point where you can just have an incredible view, right? And he's up there, and God is looking at it and saying, look at this. As far as you can see that way, as far as you can see out here, as far as you can see over here, look over here, look at all that land. See all that land? That's the land I made an oath. I promised that land to Abraham, Isaac, Jacob. That's the promised land. Looks awesome, huh? Moses is like, yeah. And God says, you're not going there. That always bugged me, right? I just think about that. So Bible says that Moses is 120 years old. His eyesight is good. His strength is good. He just climbed up the top of this mountain here. He's looking out over the promised land. And God says, okay, so you're not going in. Now, why was he not going in? Somebody answer that. He didn't follow the orders. He hit the rock. He disobeyed. Right? Okay.
One time.
Are you kidding me?
I've been with these people for 40 years. I've all the stuff they whined about and talked about, all that stuff. What are you talking about?
Okay, I know you said back here that because I struck the rock twice, that did not display your holiness, and that you were going to have me not go into the promised land. Aaron and I would not go in. I know you said that, but now that I'm looking at it, I mean, really? You're not going to, I mean, you haven't forgiven that. You haven't, like, gotten rid of that. You're not going to let me go into the land. No. I'm like, that's so unfair. Like, how many of you have sinned once, at least once? Man. How many of you have sinned, like, big time? Yeah. And it's like, man, Moses is there like, and he said, I mean, Moses was awesome, and he messed up. And God's like, yeah, you're not going. This is awesome, right? This is the best you've ever seen, right? Yeah, you're not going. But you know why? God says, I got something better for you. I got something better for you. You're not going to that land. Remember those people you're talking about? Okay, only two of them are going to actually go in there. It's called Joshua and Caleb from that first generation. Only two of them are going to go in there. So, but you're not going to go. But I'm saving you all kinds of heartache and trouble and all that stuff, because those people are going to be like these people. People are people. Right? So he says, I got something better for you. I used to think it was unfair that because he messed up once, he wasn't going to go to the promised land. But God saved him from a lot, right? And he's like, okay, I'm not going to have you go to the promised land. I've got something better for you. You're going to be with me. So here's the deal. We are so into thinking that this is it. And when we say God's got this, we're talking about this, like this life, like as if this is the main thing. Like this is our life right here. Everything's about this right now. It's not. God has something better for you. God has something better for us, right? It's called heaven. It's called a place where we're with God. It's where we're in the presence of God. Moses got a great glimpse of that, because it says he had a relationship with God that was face to face. And I mean, just an incredible relationship with God. But God said, I've got something better than that.
you're going to be with me at all times. I'm in my presence. That's the better. It's the bigger and better. It's not settling for this part. It's better. I've got this for you. In 1 Corinthians, the Bible says, this is what the scripture means when it says, no eye has seen nor ear heard, and no mind has imagined what God has prepared for those who love him. I mean, we have no idea what we the song, right? I can only imagine. We have no idea what that is like, but I can tell you this. It's way better than this, right? So if I ask you today, how many of you are perfect? If you were in heaven today and I said, how many of you are perfect? Yeah? There would be no imperfection. There's no imperfection in heaven. Man, you're going to look so much better. Like, look at the person next to you and say, man, you are going to look so much better. You might not want to say that out loud, okay? So, but it's going to be so much better. It's just so better. So the Apostle Paul said, for me, living means living for Christ, and dying is even better. So Moses, the servant of the Lord, died there in the land of Moab, just as the Lord had said. That's an interesting phrase there. That God, like, it's kind of like God says, this is how your life's going to be, and Moses' life was just like that. You know, God has a plan for your life. God has every day of your life already numbered, already figured out. You don't. It's okay. God does. You don't know when your last day is. God does. You don't know what you're going to go through. God does. You don't know what this week is going to bring. God does. You don't know the sorrow that you're going to face or the excitement that you're going to face, but God does. God has a way bigger and better plan and a better perspective on your life. And it says that Moses, like, just as the Lord has said. You know also that Moses was the only person in the Bible whom God personally buried. So it says that he died that day. He was 120, could see well, strong, and he died. And it says that God buried him, and nobody to this day knows where that is. Well, the reason nobody knows is because God didn't think that was important for us to know, for people to know, because what we would do is make a shrine out of that. It's not about Moses, it's about God, right? So it's kind of that secret burial of Moses with God. It says, there's never been another prophet like Moses whom the Lord knew face to face. So this first part is just focusing on this. You got to get this. God has something way bigger and better for you than you're thinking, than you could even imagine, that you could even plan. God has something, and it doesn't matter where your life is. Your life could be a total wreck right now. God has something way better for you. And some of you are in that process of finding the better. And doesn't that feel good? Yeah. Some of you are not, your life isn't a wreck, but you're kind of settled in the land here. And God's got, I've got something way better. Don't settle in here, right here. Keep moving forward. So it's kind of staying focused on the fact that God has something bigger and better for you. Now, the second part of this, we're going to go to the book of Hebrews in the New Testament. And we're not going to read through the whole passage, but Hebrews chapter 11, starting in verses 24 down through about 28, we go into the Hall of Faith chapter of the Bible, and we find what's recorded about Moses, and I'm just going to give you some quick things from that. But the second thing that I want you to think of, so I'm going to focus on God's got a bigger plan, but I'm going to connect that with Moses and how to live right now. And live in the right direction. So I'm going to follow, number two, follow the plan of Moses for living by faith. You guys ever heard of the Daniel plan? It's kind of a health plan that's kind of big. The Daniel plan, following the dietary plan of Daniel from the Old Testament. Well, I'm going to talk about the Moses plan according to his life here. And two key words, and you go through the book of Hebrews chapter 11, and you see two key words. What are they? By faith. By faith. So I'm going to give you four Moses plan, part one, two, three, four, that I see through this by faith two words by faith in the life of Moses that we can connect to and that we need to live by, okay? So here we go. The MP1, Moses Plan 1, involves your faith choice. Your faith choice. And this is where, like Moses, we need to learn to follow God by faith, not feelings. By faith, not feelings. It says that it was by faith that Moses, when he grew up, refused, I want you to circle the word refused, to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. He chose, I want you to circle chose, to share the oppression of God's people instead of enjoying the fleeting pleasures of sin. He thought, circle that, he thought, it was better to suffer for the sake of Christ than to own the treasures of Egypt, for he was looking ahead, circle looking ahead, to his great reward. So these key words here, this faith choice, learning to follow God by faith, not feelings. We walk by faith, not feelings. First of all, it's to refuse. There's a point of refusing. Moses refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. And instead, he did something else. So he refused that. So I see this as refusing the world's calling and rather choosing to follow God's voice. Instead of following the world's way, refuse to do that. Okay? Starts with that. Refuse to do that. And then choose to share the oppression of God's people. He chose the hard path versus sinful pleasure. Now, how many of you know that sin is fun, right? Sin is fun. Everybody knows that, right? Sin is fun for a while, for a season, right? So it says that Moses chose to share the oppression of God's people instead of enjoying the fleeting pleasures of sin. He chose the hard path versus the pleasurable path. So he chose, instead of the worldly way, God's way, instead of the pleasurable path, the hardship path. Now, we don't normally, that doesn't sound like fun, does it? That's why sin sounds way better. It sounds more fun and pleasurable. If it wasn't fun, nobody would do it, right? So he chose the hard path. Then it says he thought it was better to suffer for the sake of Christ than to own the treasures of Egypt. You see, it's this idea of thinking through your choices, thinking ahead of the consequences, thinking about your actions and how they're connected to what's going to happen in your life. Now, wouldn't it be nice that if you could say, okay, I'm going to make this choice. So I'm going to make this choice for a marriage partner. And as I'm making this choice of this woman to be my wife, I need to think ahead. Would this be wise? That I need to think ahead about what my life's going to look like with this person. Would that be wise? Wouldn't it? Instead of going, well, you know what? She's beautiful. She's friendly. I like her a lot. You know, let's get married. What's it going to be like? I have no idea. You know, so here's the deal. There's a lot of common sense involved in this. Sometimes we make decisions and we kind of know where this is going. So I do some counseling with premarital counseling and marriage counseling and stuff. But premarital counseling, talking to couples, and I find out what they're like. And it's like, okay, so you're going to marry this person and they're going to be like that. Right? So when you marry someone, they don't change into someone else. I don't know if you know that, right? How many of you are married? You realize what I'm talking about, right? So the old joke that a wedding is when there's a man and a woman standing up front, and the woman's hoping that he's gonna change, and he's hoping that she's not, And so it doesn't happen, okay? Listen to me. Now, when you're making a choice for marriage, you need to think through where this is going. I'm just telling you that. If this person is living a wrong lifestyle for you, then don't marry them, okay? They're not going to change. Now, I pray that God changes them. I'm not saying that, okay? And that's what you're praying, but you're praying it, and you're going to marry them. And then you're going to come in for counseling like 10 years later going, I don't know what happened. I'm like, I do. Okay. We had premarital counseling. I had a couple one time. We were doing counseling and the lady was like, yeah, I'm going to marry this guy. And the guy was there and we were talking. And I said, okay, does it? And I just said to her, I said, is it okay with you that after you get married, he's not going to come to church with you? And the guy was like, what? Like, I said, I didn't even look at him. I said, is that okay with you? That once you get married, he is not going to come to church with you. Are you okay with that? And she was like, oh, he's going to come to church with me. Aren't you? No, she's like, And he's like, well, what do you mean I'm not going to come to church? I said, well, because you're coming to church right now. Because you have to in order for her to marry you. But once you get married, you're not going to come to church anymore. And you're like, man, I need that kind of counseling from Pastor Ken. You know, this sounds like fun, right? He kind of got a little upset with me. I was like, I'm just saying, I've seen this, okay? I've seen this. So I just want to make sure that you're okay with the fact that once you guys get married, he's not going to be in church with you. She said, oh, I don't think that's going to happen. Yeah. So guess what happened a few months after they were married? I was saying, hey, where's your husband? She said, shut up. No, she didn't say it. It was all in here. I could hear that. But we get Moses, man, he looked ahead. He thought through the choice, and he said, look, this doesn't sound like the most fun choice. This doesn't sound like right now it's the best choice. But I can look ahead, and I can think through the consequences of this, and I want God in my life. I want to follow, and I'm not even sure about all this God thing. But I'm moving in this direction, and I made a choice. In Hebrews, it says Moses made a choice to go in that way, thinking about what was going to happen. We got to do that. We got to think through. If you're choosing a career, if you're taking a school, if you're making these choices, think through, pray through, ask God, is this the right way? Because a lot of it doesn't, it's not like rocket science. It's like a lot of common sense and prayer and just following God. But this is a faith choice. It's about learning to follow God by faith, not by your feelings. I see people, they come in and they say, I just don't feel as connected to church as I used to be. I'm like, well, because you're not. And they're like, well, what do you mean? I said, well, I haven't seen you in weeks, months. You used to do this, you used to do this, now I haven't seen you. So why do you not feel as connected? Because you're not, okay? It's not rocket science. But it's like living a life of faith, not feelings. And so Moses shows us that right up front. You have a faith choice. Learn to follow God by faith, not feelings. I hope you're not here today because you feel like it. I hope you do feel like it. But I can't count. You can't count on me being here because I feel like it any more than I can count on you, because that's not what it's about. It's about faith, not feelings. Number two, Moses' plan number two, your faith move is to leave your familiar for a new frontier. Leave the familiar for your new frontier. It was by faith that Moses left the land of Egypt, not fearing the king's anger. He kept right on going because he kept his eyes on the one who was invisible. He left Egypt, the familiar setting, 40 years in Egypt, grew up there in a nice position, and he left. And he wasn't running. The scripture is saying here, he wasn't running from the king. He was running to God in that sense. And he kept right on going. It was a journey that continued. Let me ask you a question. So your faith moved, leaving your familiar for a new frontier. What is new in your faith with God? If your faith is the same as it's always been, man, it's time to take a next step, right? Like, what does God want you, like, to settle in and just be bored? I mean, if you want to be on the board, you want to be a board member? We don't want to be board members, right? We want to be alive. We want to be on fire. We want to do what God wants us to do. We want to be awake. We want to be out there doing what God calls us to do. And you know what? So that takes faith, and it takes moving forward, and it means that you're going to do something that you are not comfortable with. It means that it's going to be new territory for you. But what are you praying? What are you asking God for? Are you asking God for safety and comfort? You've got enough of that. That is not helping you grow spiritually. You know what helped Moses grow? Getting out of Egypt. Getting out of that position. It was getting on the backside of the desert for 40 years to spend time with God and unlearn the things he needed to unlearn and relearn some things that God wanted him to learn. And it was time to get up and go. God, it says, by faith, Moses left the land of Egypt, not fearing the king's anger. He wanted to keep moving forward. Someone said, we live by faith or we don't live at all. Either we venture out or we vegetate. We risk or we rust. Hebrews 11, earlier in the chapter, says it was by faith that Abraham obeyed when God called him to leave home and go to another land. He went without knowing where he was going. Are you kidding me? That is such an anchor for us so many times that we don't know how it's going to end up. What if this? What if that? Instead of by faith, just following God. And again, I'm not saying you got to go sell your house and move somewhere. I'm just saying you got to, what's going on in your life right now? What's going on in your faith right now? That God is saying, man, I want you to take the next step. I want you to move forward. I want you to try something different. I want you to reach someone new. I want you to lead something new. Some of you are not getting involved in ministry because you're afraid. Step out of that fear and into this faith zone on this new frontier of leading something, maybe leading someone to Jesus, maybe discipling someone, maybe helping our kids. You know the kids' ministry? There are almost zero men in there, and we're wondering why our kids aren't growing up with great father figures and male influence. Man, we gotta get some guys out there. We need some guys to get involved in the children's ministry. We have groups that should be being led by people that they know enough about the Bible. You know enough. You just gotta get out there and learn way more by stepping into that new territory. Does that make sense? Like grow, like keep it going. Moses did this, man. He left his familiar for a new frontier. MP3, Moses plan number three. I'm calling this your faith app. Your faith app. Live the word no matter how weird. Live the word no matter how weird. I'm not talking about how weird you are. I'm talking about how weird the word might sound. It says that it was by faith that Moses commanded the people to keep the Passover, to sprinkle blood on the doorpost, so that the angel of death would not kill their firstborn son. This was something new, and it sounded weird. You know, you sprinkle blood on the doorpost, so your son won't die tonight. Well, that's kind of weird. Well, you know, if you go through the Bible, especially in the Old Testament, there's a lot of weird stuff God told his people to do. You know, he told Noah to build an ark, right? He had never seen rain. Nobody knew what rain was. I want you to build a boat. Okay, that sounds weird. I'm going to do that. By faith, I'm going to do that. Told the children of Israel, once they got into the land, to march around the city of Jericho that Moses is now looking at, to march around that city until the walls came down. Well, that sounds weird. I mean, there's a ton of stuff in the Bible that's just like, but that, I'm not sure. And there's a ton of stuff in the Bible that people nowadays are looking at and say, well, that's the Bible. That's old. That's past. It's gone. It doesn't really relate to today. It does. It's still the same. It's God's word. So apply that to your life. Now, if you think it's weird, but God is saying to do it, then take that step of faith. By faith, apply it. You know, application is the key to your faith development. Information is not. Application is. So if we had Bible study here every night, I think we could get more people to come to Bible study every night than we could for Bible study one night and going out and sharing our faith with others three nights. Because that's the application of the information. What do you think God's giving you information for? You get this big head, right? Woo! know just as many Bible verses as Justin McCourt, okay? Man. I'm going to have to shave my head, you know, start putting verses on me, you know? I'm kidding, Justin, you know that, right? Sorta. Okay, so, but man, information, and this little tiny heart in here. That's why I say, we got that's why we have double doors at all the exits. You know, you get so much information, and you're like, whoa, get out of here. Application is the key. Application is the key to transformation. So make sure that when you're reading the Bible, when you're studying Scripture, you're coming out there and saying, well, how do I apply this to my life? That's why we have life groups. You got to get in a life group and talk about how you're applying the principles to your life. If you're just getting information and sticking that in your Bible, that's not helping you. Application, the blood, walking around the city, building a boat, whatever it is, no matter how weird, follow God's word. And then number four, MP4, is what I call your faith legacy, and this is the last one. Leave a mark that motivates others. Leave a mark that motivates others. Moses was 120 years old when he died. His eyesight was clear. He was strong as ever. First 120 years, first 40 in Egypt, called the promo years. Second 40 in the desert, called those the slow-mo years. And then the last 40 leading Israel in the let's go years. Like, let's keep moving forward through the wilderness. You know, Moses finished well physically. He finished well spiritually. I love this. It says there had never been another prophet in Israel that God knew face to face. And also in Numbers chapter 12, verse 3, it says Moses was very humble, more humble than any other person on earth. I don't know if you picture Moses as a humble person, but I don't know. Taking a look at Charlton Heston and the Ten Commandments and humility, I don't know, it doesn't match up, like strength. But humble, here, meekness, in a sense, is strength under control. It says he was the humblest man on the planet. So here's my question to you. What's going on in your life? What's the direction of your life? Your life's going to be over on this earth before you know it. Where are you going? Not where are you going in eternity. What direction are you going right now? Is your life pointing people to Jesus Christ? Yesterday, we had Cheryl Benefield's service in here, her celebration of life. Cheryl Benefield was a member of our church since 2001. She was baptized here. She battled cancer starting in 2000. She battled cancer for 17 years. And she went home to be with the Lord on her birthday, July 27th of this year. She was 62 years old. You think she had a great birthday? Oh, man, I got to go to heaven for my birthday. I hope somebody remembers it's my birthday. You know, they had an awesome, right, awesome celebration, but we had a celebration of her service, and her daughter Jennifer was sharing, and she said this, I loved it, if you're not living the legacy in your life right now that you want to leave for others, start today. And there's always something about being in a funeral service or something like that that kind of brings our focus back to the end of our life, and where do we want that going? Maybe it's time for a change in direction. Maybe it's time for you to head toward the cross instead of away from it. You know, some of you have been running from that for a long time, and you need to run toward the cross and invite Jesus to come into your life. Listen to Moses' parting words to the children of Israel. In Deuteronomy 30, it says, I call heaven and earth to witness against you today that I have set before you life and death, the blessing and the curse. So choose life in order that you may live, you and your descendants, by loving the Lord your God, by obeying his voice, and by holding fast to him. It says in Hebrews 11, all these people mentioned earned a good reputation because of their faith, yet none of them received all that God had promised.
For God had something better in mind for us. Doesn't say them. It says us. So that they would not reach perfection without us. I love this. You know, there's a connection. There's a real connection between you and me and Moses and Aaron and Abraham, the family of faith. I was talking to the one-on-one class today. We had like 10 new people in our one-on-one class today. We were going through and I was talking about this family. We're a family of faith. We're not a perfect family, but we're a family of faith. And we're really connected. You know what really connects us? The blood of Jesus Christ. We're actually blood brothers and sisters. And it goes deeper. We are connected to the Old Testament saints. Like, they're waiting for us, and we're moving forward with them. Like, we're connected with them. I love this, that we see this. We cannot do this alone. We are connected. It's an us thing. It's not you alone. It's us. We need each other. There was a pastor of a Scottish church by the name of John Patton back in the early 1900s, and he's relatively unknown to Christians today. But John Patton was pastoring a pretty good growing church in Scotland, and God began to burden his heart for the new Hebrides, a group of Pacific Islanders. The obstacle was these Pacific Islanders were cannibalistic people. And they had no knowledge of the gospel. So he set his heart on one of the islands in particular, this pastor John. 20 years earlier, two missionaries had gone to that island and they were killed and cannibalized. So it was no surprise that when he started telling people that he wanted to go there, God was leading him there, they were thinking, hey, you don't want to go there, you are going to be cannibalized. As a matter of fact, one gentleman in particular said to him just straight out, the cannibals, you will be eaten by cannibals. John Patton replied to this man, you're advanced in your years now, and your own prospect is soon to be laid in the grave. There, it will be eaten by worms. I confess to you that if I can but live and die serving and honoring the Lord Jesus, it will make no difference to me whether I'm eaten by cannibals or by worms. And in the great day, my resurrection body will arise fair as yours in the likeness of our risen Redeemer. That's awesome, huh? Yeah. And it says, the old man left the room. I have nothing more to say after that, he said. At the age of 33, John Patton traveled to the New Hebrides with his wife. The journey was not easy. His wife and his newborn child died within months after arriving, and he found himself alone digging graves with his bare hands. He faced threat upon his life. But in the years to come, countless cannibals came to know the peace of Christ, and the church across Australia, Scotland, and the Western world was challenged to rise up and make the gospel known among people who were the toughest to reach. Man, us. This is what God is doing in us. Let's go reach people with the cross of Christ. Let's not settle for anything less, any small plans. God's great big plan for us. I want you to bow your head and have the band come up. What's it going to say on your grave marker? Good father, great mother, loving grandmother, grandfather, faithful servant. follower of Jesus, what do you want that to say? Live that now. Don't hope that people will say something about you like that. Live that out. But can I say through the life of Moses that what we would love to hear, what we want to sing today, and what we want to say, and what we want on our, we want to be marked in our life and pass this on to others. I am redeemed. God has taken my life, changed my life, saved my life, given me a new life. God has paid the price for my life, and I am a child of God because I've been redeemed. God, my prayer today is that as we go through this response time, God, as we think about the life of Moses, as we think about the life of faith, as we think about leaving a legacy, God, that we would be a people who lean forward into that as the redeemed of the Lord. I pray for those that are here today that have never made a personal profession of faith in the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, that they would come and talk to someone, pray with someone, invite Jesus to come into their life. God, I pray for each of us that we would grow closer to you today, more of you, less of me. We give this time to you. God, take our lives for your sake. In Jesus' name, amen. I want you to stand with me. We're going to close out the service with the song, I Am Redeemed. And I want our prayer partners, come on up front. If you want to pray with someone, come on up front. If you need to talk to someone about a relationship with Jesus, come on up front. We'd love to talk to you. If you want to pray together as a couple or a family, come on up. Have some prayer time. God bless. Thank you.
So I'm off these heavy chains. Walk away every step.
Today, the Bible says, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. You redeemed today? Yeah. Amen. Awesome. Hey, before we get out of here, I want to have the McNeff family come on up for a second. This is the McNeff family. They're our new missionaries that we're supporting to Argentina. And Aaron's going to introduce his family to us again, and I just want you to know they're here for here for a short stay. I'll let him update you on that and how we can pray for them. But it is so good to have them here this morning for the service. They had texted me the other day and sent me an email. And I was like, yeah, that'd be awesome to see you. So give us a little update, and then we're going to be praying for you. And then I want you to just afterwards come up and say hi to them, and have a great week, okay? So go ahead, Aaron.
Well, first of all, this was a really great service. It's just been a while. We've been in Argentina for 8 months, and my name's Aaron. This is my wife Chrissy, my daughter Kylie, and less than a week ago, we went to immigration there. And they told us that, you know, you can't stay here legally. You can't stay here past September 19th unless you get your FBI checks, background checks. So my church chose to fly us back here to L.A. is one of the places you can get it done in 24 hours, and you can be from out of state. So that's what we're doing tomorrow. So that's a big prayer request for us is that tomorrow everything goes well with that. We have to fly back at the end of the week to get to turn in the FBI request and pray that everything goes well then, because there's no telling they can say, okay, you got this, now you need something else. I don't know, but, you know, we... When you pastors were talking about taking steps of faith, and it's so true that when you do, every step you take, it's like God's word that you have in your mind, and you know it comes to life. That verse that you know, you take the step, and it just breathes through you, and you're thinking, okay, this is the way to live, not my life, but His, what He wants me to do. And when I was in Argentina, and I got the message that says, you know, you can't stay here anymore. And the place is so dark. In the city of Mendoza, the churches that are there, they're not preaching the gospel. They're not. Some of them are, don't get me wrong, but there's very few. And I know the city needs God's word. And so we got that message. And I'm not going to lie to you for a minute. I questioned God. But I know He's a big God, and He got us here. He flew us through Miami, where there was a hurricane and coming, and they were questioning if we're going to be able to leave, and He took care of that. He's taking care of everything. And just to be here today was such a huge blessing in my family's life. And so we thank Pastor, we thank the church, we thank you guys for praying for us and supporting us, and we love you. And we can't wait to to come back again, report better information, more that their church is going on there in Argentina. And right now we're just in language school trying to learn Spanish. I don't know if I'm 43 years old. I'm trying to learn Spanish. It just takes a while. And you're 43. But I'm pushing through it. My daughter knows it really well. My wife, she's right with me. She's not as old as I am, but she is. She's pushing through it. So we love you guys. Thank you for everything.
Okay. So when we talked about Christmas missions, last year we raised money for missions. Part of that offering went to the McNeff family for Argentina.
Thank you.
Okay? So now that it's not working out in Argentina, we're going to have to cut you loose. So were you thinking that? No. We're not thinking that, right? So who's got this?
God's got this.
And I love the testimony just for a minute, because we've been talking about this, you guys. That following God's will is never easy. Why doesn't he just make it easy? It's not. That cross right there says it's not going to be easy. It's a crucified life. It's a cross life. So it's never easy, but we remain faithful because God's called us to it. And you guys, you have us. We're in this with you. And we are supporting you, praying for you, love you guys. And we're so glad that you are able to be here today and encourage us mutually.
Thank you.
So can we give them a hand for being here today? Yeah. All right, let me pray us out. God, we thank you for your grace and your blessing and your strength in our lives to live out what you call us to live. God, may we be a people who are drawing closer to you and learning more about you and showing less of us and more of you. And God, we pray specifically right now for the McNeff family, with Aaron and Chrissy and Kylie and their son Trey, who's in golf school, God, and just pray that you would bless this whole family, God. Continue to take care of the details. Give them encouragement. God, we know there's always those moments of doubt, but yet, God, may that faith come boldly through in their lives today. God, may they be encouraged to go. May you take care of those needs this week and get them back on the field that you called them to. And to win people to Jesus and to build churches, your church, in the name of Jesus Christ. And God, we give them to you in Jesus' name. And all God's people said together, amen. All right. Have an awesome week. If you want to come up, say hi to the McNeffs. Give them a hug. Tell them you're praying for them. Okay? God bless you.